I'm Kimberly Arusha, Managing Director of the USGA Green Section. I'd like to welcome you to another installment in the USGA Webcast series. These presentations summarize ideas and procedures observed by the USGA agronomists as they visit golf courses throughout North America. The Green Section is not suggesting that the methods depicted are the best or only means of performing a particular task. Our goal is to share a broad variety of management techniques for the benefit of golf courses.
I would like to welcome you all to Assessing Winter Injury and Promoting Turf Recovery in the Northeast Region. Our presenters today, our panel discussion, are composed of Mr. David Oatis, who's Director of the Northeast Region, Mr. Jim Skorulski, Senior Agronomist, and Mr. Adam Moeller, Agronomist. And that may be the only time that you hear me refer to all three of these fellows as Mr. We've got a great panel today. This will be an informal discussion. Adam will lead the way, and at the end of it, we will open it up to Dave and Jim and Adam and to your questions. We thought we would start the presentation with a couple of quick poll questions just to try to get a feel for what you folks are seeing out there. And I'll try not to mess this up too bad. The first poll that you'll see asks what your role is in the golf industry. And so if you would go ahead and answer this poll for us so we get kind of an idea of what the audience is, that would be a big help. Now, you're not seeing your results just now. You will as soon as I publish the poll, which I will do in about another 10 seconds. So if you haven't voted yet, now's the time to vote. And at this point, I'll go ahead and show you the results of it. And so it's fairly obvious that the bulk of our folks are 80% superintendents. However, we definitely want to, everybody's welcome on these things, but we really like to see the that third group, golfers, course officials, and owners. We'd love to have you here because many of the things the fellows will be talking about, you know, we need you to carry out to the golfers out there so they understand exactly what has happened this year and what can be done about it. Now, the next poll that we'll ask will be, let's see here. Well, unfortunately, I'm struggling with my poll, so we'll go ahead and we'll come to those a little bit later. Adam, if you would, let me turn it over to you and let you go ahead with the presentation.
Okay, thank you very much, Jim, and welcome to everyone who is joining us. We appreciate your attendance. It's been a real challenging start to the 2014 growing season between myself, Dave Oatis, and Jim Skorulski. We've pretty much blanketed the entire Northeast region with early season visits, and it's been unfortunate to see what we've been seeing. There's not a state or Canadian province so far that we visited where we haven't either seen damage firsthand or heard reports of it, so really pretty challenging. This webinar is really not going to focus on the causes of winter damage and the wouldas and couldas and shouldas of the damage. Instead, it's really going to be focused on moving forward and promoting a rapid and sustainable recovery so we can hopefully see this turf survive and perform well this summer and then hopefully minimize damage going on in the future. So no question, the winter has been historic for many. This is an image of Lake Erie that I think many people have probably seen. Weather.com reported that the ice cover across the Great Lakes was the greatest since in the last 35 years. Just seemed like we got snow and cold weather and it never seemed to let up. Some portions of the region it got periods of rainfall which led to ice accumulation. We've really seen a lot of damage in a number of different forms as a result of the difficulty this winter. So definitely challenging, but again, moving forward to try to promote a real sustainable recovery so the grass can perform well at some point this summer, and then again, hopefully minimizing damage again next winter. So the first step in recovery, I think, is to be pretty honest with yourself and with your golf community in your area as to what are the best steps moving forward. This is a pretty telling image. There's a couple things going on here, but I think when we're talking recovery, the biggest concern I see here is that flag stick is still in the putting green. No question, recovery is going to struggle on this putting green if it remains in play. So installing a temporary green is really the best case scenario when you've got a severely damaged green. It's not popular from a golfer standpoint, but you'd much rather see a temporary green in the spring so the greens can perform well in the summer. And that is a revenue challenge, definitely, when you think of, you want, you know, your golfers to be playing a fair amount of golf in the spring to get that revenue stream going. But I think you got to be honest with yourself. Much more concerning would be having temporary greens in the summer, because you delayed opening the, or you delayed promoting recovery through winter damage. So do what's best from an agronomic standpoint and try to shut the green down if it's severely damaged, and install a temporary green. And I would say, you know, put some thought and time and effort into these temporary greens. They're certainly not going to, you know, be as enjoyable as the regular greens on the course, but if you take some time to think about where you can put these to maybe add a little bit of extra challenge and fun for the golfers playing the greens, even though they're damaged, it can be worthwhile. And we see this time and time again, where we see much more successful recovery programs when a temporary green is installed. After that, I would say, you know, as soon as it's feasible at your golf course, get the irrigation system up and running. We've made a number of visits already where we see turf that looks damaged, and as you peel back the layers, you see crowns that are still alive. They're just very, very weak. And at this point, the turf cannot tolerate excessive soil drying. So get the irrigation system up and running. Not pushing the envelope when it comes to drying the turf down. Definitely, we like to see courses that promote drier conditions in the spring to help pre-stress condition the turf as it enters the summer. But if it's weak from winter issues, now it's not the time to do that. Just keep things moist so stuff doesn't go south for you. The next situation then is trying to figure out the best strategies to promote recovery, either through seeding or sodding. And I will say, we've had a number of conversations with different courses already as to, you know, really be careful with your assessment of the greens. It's easy to get too aggressive and actually set the weak turf back. So in some instances, with the cold snap that we've had recently in the Northeast, you might be better off just, you know, taking a little bit of time to make sure you know what's still hanging on, and maybe, you know, being honest with yourself as to what's dead. So taking some time to make sure you know what's going on with the damaged areas is pretty important. Once the weather looks good, and you've got a real good idea of what's alive and what's not, that's the time to get in and create a seed bed. There's a lot of options to do it. What I will say is you're much better off getting in and sort of doing it right the first time, creating one seed bed, as opposed to, you know, not creating a very good seed bed and then having to go back and redo it again in a week or two, and that's just going to damage other seedlings. So a lot of options to consider, really depending upon your equipment that you have available, but some of the combos that we typically see working well, close center, shallow core aeration, verticutting in two directions or maybe more, slice seeding with a lot of different tools out there, dimple seeding, and combinations of all of the above. Really, the key is seed-to-soil contact. If you don't get into the soil and you're just hitting a thatch layer, that might challenge those seedlings to recover and germinate. So that's important, but you also want to make sure you still have that thatch layer there, because it's going to provide some resiliency. So here's just a quick snapshot. Again, a lot of different options that golf course superintendents have utilized successfully, and it kind of depends on your situation as to what's going to work best with your equipment. So after you've created a good seed bed, I would suggest overseeding the areas. Creeping bentgrass is going to be the ideal species, obviously, in the Northeast region. Not overdoing it with seed, understanding that some of this seed is probably not going to germinate just based on the fact that you're trying to seed into a mat layer of some form. If you go real, real heavy with the seed, that's going to increase your susceptibility to some of this seed sort of failing out once it gets real hot in the summer. Top dressing afterwards is always helpful to, you know, bury that seed and put it down so it doesn't wash away if you do get some rain. Adding a starter fertilizer component, I think, is always helpful in any establishment situation, and the same is true for putting green recovery. And then from a nitrogen component, you know, with the temperatures and soil temperatures still being so low, that's where I would suggest using some sort of a quick-release material. Ammonium sulfate comes to mind, but there's a lot out there that will promote growth. If you use a predominantly slow-release material, it's just not going to have much activity. But that being said, don't overdo it. If you force too much growth, you force too much shoot growth at the expense of root growth, you're going to blow through the plant's carbohydrate energy reserves, and that could lead to, you know, really succulent turf come July, which might not perform up to par. So after the fertility components are sort of done, I would look to do as much as you can to improve the growing environment. You know, soils, like I said, are still really, very, very cold, so using covers or black top dressing sand to artificially warm the soil is a good idea to hasten germination. There's a lot of options out there with permeable covers. I've seen some courses actually go to like a big box store and buy some clear plastic covers and cut them to the specific areas that are damaged, making sure you've got enough moisture in the soil, obviously, before you put down the clear plastic covers if they don't let water through. So here's just a little snapshot of sort of the benefits of covers. Obviously, they warm the soils underneath and really can help promote rapid germination. And picture certainly tells a thousand words in this situation. You look at the covered side on the right versus the non-covered side on the left, and it's not perfect where the cover was there, but I think we'd all agree it's a lot stronger, and it's going to be a lot closer to being open for play. And again, the great part with covers is you can cut them to the specific areas that are damaged if it's isolated enough. In some instances, you may have to cover the entire green if the damage is bad enough. You could also look into using plugs for smaller areas. This would be a great option if you've got a nursery green or a chipping green where you can take some plugs from and basically just you know, really hammer those areas that are weak. That'll help obviously improve recovery, but hopefully if you're plugging with bank grass, you're making things a little bit stronger for the next winter. Then once things are, you know, starting to become established with seed, the fertility program is really a growing program. Light and frequent nitrogen applications, you know, relying predominantly on a quick-release soluble nitrogen source every 3 to 5 to 7 days, sort of depending upon the rate. And again, I would say, you know, be conservative here. You know, you can easily find yourself overdoing it with too much nitrogen, and that could actually set yourself up for more issues as the summer progresses. So light and frequent is definitely the better case scenario. Mowing inputs, this is always challenging when you have a green with isolated damage spots as to how you mow one area versus the other. But no question, mowing conservatively is going to improve recovery. Walk behind mowers are ideal with solid front rollers. And the mowing height is going to depend on your situation, but we see the most success with the higher heights. Anywhere between 160 and even 200 might be needed if the damage is bad enough. And then lightly top dressing as the recovery continues to smooth that surface. We've seen a lot of instances where not only with winter damage but with summer issues, an area might look pretty bad, but with some light top dressing, typically by hand, it can actually play really, really well. So keep that the top dressing in there, you know, being careful with brushing only if absolutely necessary. But ideally, it'd be light enough just with a push spreader that things will be smooth and you won't have to brush it. Sodding is always an option that we seem to answer questions about. It's oftentimes an instant gratification type situation where, you know, you've got damage, you sod it, and it's got to be perfect, right? Well, I think we'd all agree from an agronomic standpoint, sodding is not nearly as good as seeding. It does result in a faster recovery, typically, but it's important to realize that sod could easily struggle once it comes to the summer stress, especially if you're purchasing it from off-site, pure bank grass sod, putting it in a location where, you know, for instance, a green that doesn't drain very well, or in a shaded environment where bank grass is just set up for problems. So keep that in mind. Ideally, sodding from your own nursery green or, you know, the chipping green where it's under your management programs is something to consider. And then if you are sodding, keep in mind that, you know, these isolated sod spots are going to be much harder to manage. If you've got a putting green that's completely wiped out, that's kind of the best case scenario for sod, because then the entire green can be maintained the seam as opposed to having these sodded patches. So just keep that in mind with sodding. It might appear like things are perfect, but that root system is going to struggle, and that sod often will decline if it's not really managed gently throughout the whole season. And then, you know, the million-dollar question is, when can you open for play? And that's a very difficult situation to be in, answering those questions. But I would encourage everyone to make the decision based on agronomy, not revenue. That's much easier said than done. But agronomically, again, it's much more important to have a sustainable recovery where the grass is going to perform well once the summer hits. If you open too early, it's very likely that that grass will struggle come July and August, and that's really when the revenue is most important. And then finally, communicate with your golfers on what they can expect. You know, it's unfortunate that winter injury occurs, but in this situation, it seems like the majority of the Northeast has experienced it, so it's not something that, you know, you shouldn't feel isolated as to you're the only course that has some damage. So communicate to golfers and be honest that, hey, we've got some damage. We need temporary greens for you know, a month or two, depending upon the situation, and we're going to do our best to get things back and recovered. So, you know, expecting perfect conditions, you know, May 1st is probably not realistic. June 1st, again, depending upon your situation, maybe not realistic, but hopefully by the better part of the summer, you can have things that are, you know, up to par. Some quick tips on preventing winter injury. We won't really touch on this, and maybe it's best to save this for the question and answer section. But it's pretty simple. There isn't the magic solution. Use of covers, you know, don't guarantee success. If they did, everyone would use them, and that'd be the end of it. No question, in the Northeast, we've seen the majority, if not the entirety, of the grass that has succumbed to winter damage being poannua. So bent grass is a much, much stronger grass long term. This is probably your best insurance policy for winter injury. It does come with some, you know, challenges that you need to make sure it's got the right growing environment, but it's a much stronger grass agronomically, so that might be again your best case scenario. Doing what you can to improve the plant's ability to tolerate winter conditions through maximizing the cold temperature acclimation and carbohydrate reserves throughout the fall is really important. And that really revolves around sunlight. Water management, fertility, and the mowing height play a role, but sunlight is the absolute key. And then finally, if you've got some surface drainage issues that you could address through either rebuilding or subtle recontouring, addressing collar dams, things like that, those are no-brainers to try to take care of. And then in some situations, an impermeable cover system, which will help minimize the potential for water hitting the turf surface, might be something to consider, but those come with consequences. They need to be managed. It's not as easy as just putting a cover down and forgetting about it until the spring. So, and again, I can't stress this enough. The shade issues are consistently, you know, putting greens that have shade issues are consistently the ones that we see more and more winter injuries. So, you know, if that'd be my number one take home, I'd say address shade issues long term. That's going to help you, you know, get healthier grass, not only for the summer, but also as you come out of the winter and into the spring each year. So with that, I'd like to open it up for the question and answer session. And again, thanks for your attention so far. So feel free to chime in and answer or ask any questions.
Okay, Adam, we do have some. I have one right off the bat. Please tell me that sign about expect no miracles wasn't on a golf course, because, you know, as a 50-year golfer, there's never had a hole in one. I'm not playing that course if that's on a golf course.
Actually, that was on a golf course out on the east end of Long Island, but the golf course was an old racetrack, so that's where the phrase came from.
That makes sense. Okay. Yeah. Well, one of the questions that came in involved the extent of the injury, so I did get the polling feature straightened out, so let me go ahead and let's ask the audience to help us kind of get a feel for the extent of the winter injury this year. So please go ahead and answer the poll. And as before, you know, I'll give you 15 or 20 seconds here, and then I'll go ahead and publish it at that point. And we're getting a pretty good response. I'm going to give you about another 10 seconds to vote, and then at that point, we'll share the results of it. And it looks like it was a pretty rough year in the Northeast, as you guys have been saying. So sounds like this webinar was certainly justified. We have one more that we'd like to run. And this involves fairways. So if we could, we'd like to get you to make your selection here. And fellows, just to let you know, the first question is going to be, to what extent of the of injury is there in the region? I know you guys have a large region, so maybe you can address from one end of it to the other. Let me go ahead and publish this one. And it looks like, well, that's a lot of fairway acreage, isn't it? And so, okay, with those out of the way, fellows, if you would, how about addressing that first question as far as how widespread it, was the damage in your region?
Okay, Jim, I will, I'll start. First of all, I guess Dave Oatis and I visit primarily the western half of the Northeast region, if you can split it up that way, and Jim covers most of New England. But I've seen damage in New Jersey, Long Island, the metropolitan area of New York to some extent, all the way up into southern Ontario, into the Toronto area, the London, Ontario area. It's pretty much everywhere. It's definitely more severe the further north you go. But there isn't a portion so far that we haven't really seen, haven't heard any reports in southern New Jersey, but it's pretty much everywhere.
Jim, hang on one second, Jim. By the way, for those of you that are wondering why the screen says Dave Oatis speaking when it's obviously Adam. Adam and Dave are in their office at Golf House sharing Dave's computer, so I hope you can tell the difference between Adam and Dave. Don't let that confuse you. Okay, Jim, go ahead. I'm sorry.
I would agree with Adam and what he is seeing. It's pretty much widespread across the New England states and then eastern Canada as well. And it's spotty in some parts of the locale, and the further north you go, and kind of central and northern New England, it seems to be very severe. Some of the coastal areas, very severe. Where we have more snow, they seem to protect the grass from some of the flash freezes we had early in the season, and maybe the big snowpack absorbed some of the ice, so it never made it quite to the surface. But it's devastating, and really some courses have large acreages of fairways and entire green surfaces are hit pretty hard, so it's devastating for some.
Dave Oatis, for the fellows, from the folks here from Canada, can you comment on what you saw up there?
Yeah, I was in southern Canada about 3 weeks ago, and I can honestly say I never experienced what I did then before, and that was I actually drove out onto the first golf course that I visited, opened my car door to get out at the maintenance facility, and I was sort of assailed by the smell of rotting turf. I've smelled anaerobic soils hundreds of times, excuse me, over the years, but I've never seen and experienced the smell coming off that turf, and it kind of permeated all my clothes, actually. It was remarkable. They experienced snow and more likely ice cover for 75 to 80 plus days, and so there was just a lot of rotting turf under that ice layer, even though the soils were frozen very, very deep.
For the folks that are, you know, for our golfer side of the attendance today, I think a question that every golfer and obviously every superintendent has as well is, when is it likely that greens, you know, severely injured greens can be reopened, and what are some of the criteria that you guys look for when somebody asks you, what do you think, can I open it up?
Jim, I'll jump in on that. Number one, as Adam pointed out, no one likes to have temporary greens, but in my experience, having watched recovery hundreds of times, and I think Jim Skorulski will certainly vouch for this because he's seen even more of it up farther north, putting a green that's damaged into play too quickly will easily double, maybe longer than doubling, the recovery time. In addition, the traffic's going to kill the bentgrass seedlings or be a lot more damaging to the bentgrass seedlings than the poa seedlings. So like it or not, winter injury does provide us an opportunity to get new and better, you know, improved bent grasses established in our greens. So if you look at it as an opportunity, do all the steps that Adam went through and then keep the greens out of play till you have essentially 100% turf cover and a little bit of maturity, this could be an opportunity to improve your golf course, improve your foundation of turf so that you'll have better performance in the future. And if you keep things in play, you're going to prolong the agony and your course will be weaker in the long run after it all. Absolutely. The old oil filter commercial is very apropos right now.
Dave's absolutely right. And one of the problems that we see too is golf courses will both play temporary greens. The members will cooperate and they'll be patient initially. But as we get into it and you start to get turf cover, things look better than they are. And what I say is you might have full turf cover, but you don't have maturity, you don't have density. So there's a real temptation to open up greens even before they're ready. And yes, you can use perimeter hole locations. And yes, you can do a good job of moving traffic on and off greens. But sporadic play at best. And the longer you keep them closed, the quicker your real greens will be back. And I think the other issue is, too, that it just, you know, no matter how good the recovery is, these are not going to be your greens, the greens that you're accustomed to, the greens you're used to, you know, probably until midsummer. And that's if all goes well. They'll be puttable, they'll be playable. But they're not. It's, you know, you just have no choice. You're doing a grow-in in April, and to try to do that with play on the greens just doesn't make sense. So if you've got the majority of the surface is damaged, or if you've got your primary hole locations are damaged, which they often are because they're the flatter or low-lying pockets on greens, then it is best to keep them closed.
Okay. We have a question from Stephen Wilson, and his question is, can overseeding with perennial ryegrass be beneficial to help bent seed establishment? I'm assuming he's referring to fairways, but maybe you guys can address that better.
Well, I can go for that one. I'll try that one. You know, if you do seed perennial ryegrass into fairways, you can count on it being a persistent plant out there. And actually I've seen that used as a nurse on putting greens, and it lasts even longer on putting greens than what you would anticipate it to be there. So it's a pretty competitive plant.
Jim, Stephen did come back and say he was referring to greens.
Yeah, I honestly, if you're going to use a nurse crop, even on fairways or greens, I'd be much more comfortable with a Chewings fescue and fairly high seeding rates of fescue. I mean, but, you know, at least that will fade away and won't compete with the bent grass. So that would be a much better choice in my opinion.
Boy, Jim, I would really agree with that. You know, my favorite description of perennial ryegrass is that it's a Murphy's Law grass. It will not die when you want it to, and then, of course, it does die when you don't want it to. I've seen it persist in putting greens at very low cutting heights for years to the point where they actually had to plug it out. So I would not recommend that for sure.
Dave, I got to pitch in here, and those on the attending probably have no idea where I live, but I live in the middle of Texas, and I will tell you that overseeded ryegrass is living in fairways. Perennial ryegrass is living in fairways down here year round now. So if it's going to live down here year round, you know darn well it would have the same problem where you fellas are.
The new ryes are just too good almost for these situations.
Here's one. Can you address, and this is a whole topic that we have addressed on other articles and other webcasts, but maybe you guys can just touch on it. And can you address the pros and cons of ice removal and the timing of it? If possible, base it strictly off days under ice, or is there a better metric? Steve Curta asked that. I'm not exactly sure what he's referring to, but can you guys address the ice removal issue at all?
I can start it anyway. It's always a risky decision, and Sometimes the action that you take to remove ice is going to cause some physical injury. Just taking off a snow cover above an ice layer, you're going to lose any insulation you have for the turf. So exposing grass, for instance, we've had flash freezes in January this year, and we had ice, and you know, you look at the season ahead and you say, my goodness, if I don't get it off now, how many days will it be on? So if I do take it off, then I am exposing the turf to possibly below zero temperatures. It's almost a no-win situation in some cases, and you have to have some luck with the weather that occurs after you take action. As far as days of cover, you know, that's, to be honest with you, there are some metrics that we use as guidelines. Where under a real dense cover of ice, you might start to get an anoxic condition where you get that sickly sweet fermentation smell. And that can occur even after 40 days. And to be honest with you, I've had reports this year, which were surprising, that the smell is even indicated earlier than that. Just because you start to get the smell doesn't mean there's a problem necessarily. And then we do get really concerned when ice is in place for 60 days. But those are just really rough estimates. It's always a good idea to monitor through the ice and see what you have. Is the ground completely frozen below the ice, or impermeable covers, maybe? Those are the other issues that we worry about with anoxia. And then you really have to look at the forecast afterwards and determine, you know, is it wise to remove everything when the grass is going to be exposed to super low temperatures? So it's not an easy decision.
One thing I've learned a lot from being editor of the Record and reading the things that you fellows write, it appears to me that this might have been one of the most difficult years in a long time to make that decision because of the ebbs and flows of the winter and the spring. Is that correct?
Absolutely, Jim. I just looked at some temperature information, and some of the flash freezes that we had in January were, you know, 55 degrees, from 59 down to, you know, minus 1 and minus 2. Some places were even colder. And, boy, we had multiple flash freezes like that, and then it got cold and persistent, and ice was in place. So there's so many factors that impacted cold temperature injury this year, and you know, there are multiple mechanisms that kill grass in the winter. They're all related to cold temperature injury. And there are just too many circumstances for that to occur. Whether you had an ice pack that was in place, you know, for 60, 70, 90, some have had it over 100 days, of just the placement of the ice over the grass and that anoxic condition will, you know, really reduce the plant's ability to tolerate cold temperature. Maybe the plant ice started to melt, snow started to melt back in March, and a few of those days we had situations where we had a good thaw going. Ground was completely saturated and it would drop down to the teens at night. Well, that by itself could kill the grass. So, you know, it could have, some of it happened in January, probably some of it happened through the winter, and much of it happened even in March.
Right. We're piling up some questions here, so I want to be sure and get to them. Listen, one of the things that I want to stress to everybody is a lot of these topics are covered in articles that we have published on USGA.org in the course care area, and actually Ty McClellan, our manager of education, put together a document that has links to many of these articles. So, you know, be sure and refer to that. Here's a question regarding drainage. It's let's see, it's from Peter Hasek. Peter asks, he's talking about the fact that some observations this year were that some better draining greens didn't perform well under winter conditions. He said, my November verdigrain to 8 inches was frozen solid. Any thought on improved drainage as far as being a negative this year?
Let me jump in on that one. Improved internal drainage can help the turf harden off better in the fall and get the turf healthier going into the winter. And in some situations, better drainage through the winter can reduce damage. I actually saw one example this year where drained greens performed much better than non-drained greens. And I'm talking about old soil-based greens that historically don't drain very well. But in many cases, if the soil's frozen, it could be a USGA green or a soil-based, you know, clay soil-based green. If it's frozen, that soil won't drain. So drainage improves your chances, but it is absolutely not a guarantee that you will not have winter injury. It helps, but in, like I said, one instance this year I saw a significant difference where they had drainage, but I certainly wouldn't promise that to occur every year.
I think what Peter was getting at, Dave, is that it might have actually, he's heard some comments that better drained greens were actually more susceptible to winter injury. You wouldn't agree with that, would you?
I certainly haven't seen that in the southern part of the region or in southern Canada, the western part of the region, but maybe Jim has seen something else up there.
Okay. I'd like to, we've got a question from Nick Masterpole. Nick says, I'm on the board of a private club that had some damage, and my two takeaways from this call are we might be better off without some of the poa grass that was killed, and we can now overseed these areas with bent. And number two, that unhealthy greens that are shaded in the summer were hit worse. And this is another reason to remove trees that shade greens. Is this a good conclusion? I think we would all nominate Nick to the golfer of the year for in terms of his observations. But can you guys address the fact that, you know, the fact that some people have lost a lot of grass that actually, as bad as that is, maybe you can turn lemons into lemonade here?
Sure. Let me just jump on that. I asked Adam to go back a couple of slides. First of all, if you have more light, you have a better chance of growing more bent grass. Bent grass has a much higher light requirement than poa does. So in a low-light environment, poa is the better adapted species. So just flipping the switch and getting more sunlight out there is going to make everything healthier. It increases your opportunities to grow bent grass. The thing that most people, most golfers, don't realize is that winter shade also plays a role. Winter shade at a time when the turf isn't growing is not intuitively going to be a factor, but it really does. Where you have winter shade, turf stays frozen longer, and therefore more likely to experience freeze-thaw cycles, which do most of the damage. So the slide that's up there right now, it was taken in the late winter, and you can clearly see the shade pattern corresponds perfectly to the area of damage. Coming back to that golf course in May, June, July, August, you'd not see any sun or any shade on the green at this time. So it's really just a winter shade problem that's causing the problem here. So absolutely, more sun all year long, even when the grass isn't growing, is going to improve your chances.
And then I'll follow up on that, Jim. Absolutely, you know, it's frustrating to have winter injury, but this is a great opportunity to improve long-term sustainability, to get more bent grass on the putting greens, which is, you know, just going to make things that much healthier. You know, trying to keep the presentation short, I cut out a few slides, and one of them was a picture that showed winter injury from 1 year, and you could see a line of bent grass right through the middle of it. That was winter injury from a previous year. And, you know, they would have had far worse damage had they not been able to get more bent grass established in that swale where they had some winter injuries. So it's definitely the stronger grass. It does come with, you know, some extra requirements. If you don't do tree work, you know, you're not likely to have bent grass perform well in those areas. But long term, it's a great grass that can help minimize the potential for winter injury.
Yeah, that's a common theme even further south, and I know nobody's interested in southern golf courses on this call, but there's a lot of damage experience down in this part of the world too, and I think superintendents here are trying to do the same thing as the fellows in the Northeast. They're trying to identify the major causes, and this was one of those winters, I think, across the country that even if you did everything right, there was a good chance you'd have some damage. And once they've identified it, then they're focusing on moving forward, and it's an opportunity to come out actually better than you were before the damage happened. Vince, I'm sorry if I say this wrong. Matics, M-A-T-I-C-S, offers a good suggestion about using primed bent grass seed to hasten establishment. Do you guys have a source for that, or do you agree with the idea of using pre-germinated or primed seed?
Sure, I absolutely. I don't have a source handy right in front of me right now, but I even know of a couple of golf courses that have gone and made the effort to prime their own seed, and it worked. It certainly does provide a little bit of a jump, and I would recommend it, especially if you get further north where it's definitely cooler and probably more of a chance for some of the annual bluegrass to get reestablished in greens. And it definitely did help. But as Adam mentioned in his presentation, really just the focus, the goal is to try to warm up the soils and do that as quickly as possible with covers and maybe a coloring agent of some sort, whether you dye or you use black sand or something like that, and just try to get the temperatures up. And the extra 3 or 4 days you get, maybe 5 days, 6 days from a prime seed, it's great. But I think I'd probably take the path of focusing on warming up soil temperatures and making a good seed bed.
A good segue into the next question. And by the way, if you're looking for something like how to do pre-germinated seed, if you get on the course care section of USGA.org, there's a place there to search the entire green section record all the way back to 1921. And we've had numerous good articles on how to do that. So be sure and search the record for those articles. But Jim Flett addresses a question about a topic that you just brought up, Jim. Are there concerns of having black sand in the canopy when hot temperatures arrive later in the season? And I'm going to tie Bob Marshall's question into this as well. Even with coverage, we're struggling to get soil temperatures consistently above 50. How many days of plus 50 do you need to see seed start to pop? So if you could address if there's concerns with black sand, and how many days of 50 plus degree temperature do you feel like it's going to take for the seed to germinate?
All right, Jim, I'll jump in and answer this one. I really don't see any issues with the black sand causing things to heat up too much necessarily. With covers, that is something that if you put down some permeable covers to warm the soils and you get a very warm day, you will need to remove those if it gets too warm underneath the covers. But from black sand, I don't think they're going to heat up to a point where it would be potentially damaging to the turf. And then from the second part of the question, how many days is it going to take to recover, or is it going to take for germination to occur? That's going to be a real challenging. What I will say is I know there's some shortages with seed in at least southern Ontario, but what I would say is once you get consistently soil temperatures in that low 50s, that's when you are going to see germination. As you get closer to 60, 70, 80 degrees, underneath those covers, that's when you need to worry about it from an air temperature standpoint anyways. So how many days it really, that's highly, highly variable. I don't think we can really answer that. But, if your soil temperatures are in the low 40s and there's no way for you to warm them up, I would say you're better off probably waiting a little bit till you can get those soil temperatures, at least into the upper 40s, low 50s.
Okay. Chris Freilinghaus. I'm sorry, Chris. I'm doing the best I can. Kind of another related question to this, fellows. Would you allow play on a damaged green up until the seed germinates?
Well, that's an interesting question. I guess the answer in my mind would be no, because I would assume that you have some live plants that are maybe hanging on by the skin of their teeth. If you can confirm that you have 100% death and you're not going to seed for another week or two, then by all means, go ahead and play away. But I don't see, at least down here, too many situations where it's that bad. I would say there's a lot of live turf in central and northern New Jersey and upstate New York, and that's the turf you want to protect. So I would not allow play on it.
Okay. Here's a disease issue. Patrick Lang asks, do I need to put out a fungicide right now for fusarium or cool season brown patch?
I'll jump in, Jim. I guess we've seen a few courses do this when they're, using the covers to help stimulate a lot of recovery and germination, and they're keeping things moist underneath those covers. So it's something to at least keep in mind, but the more you monitor the temperatures underneath those covers, I think the better you're going to be able to make that decision. We've seen plenty of courses just, you know, manage things with those covers without having a protectant fungicide down. But again, if it gets real, real moist and real warm underneath those covers, you could easily see some disease activity. Taking it a step further, I'd be, you know, extra cautious from a disease management standpoint throughout the rest of the summer, because with a lot of this weak young grass, it's going to be much more susceptible to other pest issues.
Okay. Paul Pritchard asked, and Paul, I'm going to end up pushing you off a little bit, so bear with us here. He asked, he said, I might have missed this, but what machine or method works best to get optimum seed-to-soil contact to ensure the success? And Paul, the way I'm going to push you off is, yesterday we had a webcast from the North Central region, and because we try to keep these things fairly short, no region can cover all the topics, and the North Central went into quite a bit of detail on the various methods of establishment. In about 3 hours, this issue of the Green Section Record will come out. And if you'll click on the North Central Regional Update, you'll see a link to their webcast. Unfortunately, because the Northeast webcast is so close to our print time on the record, we couldn't get the link to this webcast in this issue of the Northeast. So anyhow, fellas, I'm not saying you can't address it, but as you guys know, I think y'all watched some of it yesterday too. They went into more detail. So Paul, if you would, get the record today. If you're not getting the record, I just don't know why you need to do that. And if you'll look on the North Central Regional Update, you'll get a good webcast on that. Do you fellas want to add anything on establishment?
Just one quick point, Jim. Most of the time we think of the thatch layer as being, you know, a negative, but as Adam mentioned, it's very important to not cultivate so much that you lose it, because you'll wind up with perhaps soil erosion, and you need it for resiliency, holding the soil in place, and you need it to cushion the new seedlings. So however you do the seed bed, there's a million ways to do it. Do it once, do it well, and then try to leave it alone. And if you need to reseed beyond that, use very non-disruptive techniques. So I'll leave it at that.
That's a great point, Dave, and that's one the fellows yesterday emphasized, is that It could take longer than usual this year for seed to germinate. And if you get impatient and go back out there after 8 or 9 days because you don't see much and rip everything up again, you just lost whatever time you had already spent. So
that's exactly the point.
Yeah. Michael, you know, Michael, I'm sorry, I'm not even going to butcher your name. I'm just going to leave it at Michael. Michael says, it seems that new covers are causing more damage than the old ripped covers that breathe better. Are you guys seeing this in your travels?
I'll take that one. You know, I've heard that, and actually we did a How It's Done webcast last fall, and some of the guys up in Montreal who get extended periods of ice cover and snow above an impermeable cover will find that they can get some breathing through some holes and punctures, and the grass in those areas certainly comes through a little bit better, and they don't see the anoxic conditions. So there would be some truth to that. Unfortunately, though, if you start punching holes and such into an impermeable cover, you might lose its effect. You'd probably get more water coming through. So if you are going to use an impermeable cover, as Adam mentioned, there is some management to those, and to a point where you might want to consider some passive ventilation under there. So you can vent them in case there's a need to do so. If you've been under, you know, heavy ice cover and you're worried about not seeing the grass there for a while, and you go further west and up into the Edmonton area, and the guys are using gas meters up there and monitoring their CO2 and oxygen levels under covers, and they will vent based on that information from the gas meter. So I think that's a little bit better way to go and using impermeable covers and not worrying about putting holes in them and so forth.
Well, Jim, as you know, the guy who's always trying to figure out these how it's done, that sounds like the use of these meters might be a great how it's done sometime. I'd love to see that one. I'm going to combine AJ Mars and Michael Iacono's question. AJ says, and these are really both comments that more than questions, but he said, out of 39 holes at our course, we vent drained 30 of them. All 39 suffered the same fate, some injuries. And then Michael refers to a comment earlier by Peter. He says, I agree with Peter. My two best draining greens are the worst greens. I have had other greens with poor drainage struggle before, but these two, first winter damage in my 22 years. So I don't know, fellas, I know what seems to be the common theme here is that there was no guarantee to get through this winter unscathed, and this winter acted much differently than most winters in the past, but maybe you can address that fact if you would.
Sure, Jim. I'll jump on that again. We really haven't seen any issues with better draining greens up to this point. And it's important to, you know, acknowledge this was such a severe winter that, you know, I think it's a good time to reevaluate things from a winter standpoint. You know, if you're fairly convinced that greens that don't drain well perform better, you know, I guess I'd be more concerned with how they perform then in the summer, because, you know, good draining greens are a foundation of good golf conditions and healthy turf in the summer. So it's an interesting observation, but, you know, I would say having good drainage on greens is so crucial in the summer that, you know, it doesn't necessarily make sense as to why they'd be damaged this year. You know, maybe it's just an anomaly, but you know, there really wasn't a right decision to be made with I think the damage this year with respect to, you know, covers and ice removal and things like that. So it's important to, you know, reevaluate things and look at big picture stuff like trees and the grass species that you've got in your golf course. You know, from a drainage perspective, I think there's still a huge benefit to having, you know, adequate drainage in your greens for the summer.
Yeah, can I? I just want to add one thing too. I was on a golf course on Tuesday, and they did have drains, and actually some of the over the drain lines did get hurt, and you know, we're trying to figure that out, and you know, you just don't quite know. I would have hated to have seen what those greens looked like without drains. They probably would have been worse. You know, and I just don't know. Sometimes, you know, you'll see things that just depends on how that weather sets up. Possibly a better drain green, which is really, is I'm stretching it here, going out on a limb, but, you know, could it be the fact that maybe it did drain out better before a freeze thaw? Maybe it wasn't insulated because it wasn't wet. I don't really know, so it might have gotten a colder temperature without monitoring temperatures. We don't know. There's just so many factors involved with it and so many weather-related variables that it's really hard to figure out why that would be the case this year.
Well, let me ask. Some years, Go ahead.
Well, some years you'll have northern exposure greens that absolutely get taken out, and, you know, and other years the northern exposures will survive just perfectly, and areas that are southern exposure will be the areas that that get taken out. I was on a golf course in Maine probably 3-4 weeks ago, and on the same golf course, low-lying pockets were damaged and went to another green, and some of the lower swales were actually pretty good, and some of the higher mounds were taken out, which shows me there's probably different mechanisms there. The exposed areas got taken up by cold temperature maybe earlier in the season, and the lower pockets maybe succumbed to crown hydration injury later, you know. So just too many variables to give you a good answer.
Well, you know, one of the things I've seen for years when we have bad winters is a direct correlation between how hard greens are pushed and how much damage occurs. And for instance, it's not uncommon at all to see older courses with soil-based greens that tend not to be pushed as hard because that's the only way they can survive the summer, actually do better in a bad winter because they went into winter, you know, at a higher cuts and under less stress than the courses that have higher expectations. Did you guys see any correlation between greens that are pushed really hard in terms of things like cutting height and stem meter speed and the degree of winter injury?
I can't say that I saw a direct correlation this year, Jim, but I was glad you mentioned that because that was one of the points I wanted to get to. I don't think we're raising cutting heights in the fall. I talked to a superintendent the other day that, you know, said, well, gosh, you know, I raised them all the way up to 120, and that occurred in late October. Well, that's past, you know, time when this turf is storing all its carbohydrates. So I think we're definitely sending the turf into the winter weaker, and it's certainly not going to come out any stronger if we do that. So This year was so severe, I'm not sure that it made a huge difference, but many other years, I believe that does make a difference. So I'd say we need to raise cutting heights sooner in the fall, get more leaf area up there to pick up more sunlight.
Well, Jason Adams sounds like he's on the same page with you fellas, Dave, particularly what you just commented on. He says, I believe that late fall practices like drill and fill and dragging of sands did not have the opportunity to heal properly versus years past. It got cold very quickly in November, and shaded areas went into snow cover somewhat stressed. Did you guys see that?
Jim, I wouldn't say we saw a direct correlation with that either, but no question, we're seeing more and more key cultural programs like aeration and others that are pushed further and further closer to that window where the turf is going to stop growing. And the more you beat that turf up really late season, you're setting yourselves up for a weaker turf entering the winter. So definitely something to consider there. And then to follow up on Dave's point before with the cutting heights, as cutting heights have gotten lower and lower, we might still be raising the heights up in preparation for the fall. But the height that we would raise them up to 30 years ago is a heck of a lot different than the height that we're raising them up to now. And so we're building more carbohydrates as we raise that height of cut, but we're still ultra, ultra low. And then to finish that point, as the heights have gone lower and lower, we've also selected out a lot more bentgrass, and we see poa annua populations increase at these golf courses. So that's a combination of things that are increasing winter injury susceptibility.
Okay, now here's two questions that are tied together that are being asked, I think, all over the country right now. If you've got some damage, Brian Willie says, should we be spraying growth regulators on greens that have winter injury, or should we hold off on this for a while? And then Joe Gallagher ties into it. He says, if we had major turf loss, should we still be using seed head control on the living poannua?
I'll jump in with that one again there, Jim. I guess, it's a green by green decision from when you're making growth regulator applications. That said, when you've got these spots in your greens that are damaged and the rest of the green is healthy, it's a tough decision. Once you get adequate recovery, let's say 80 to 85% germination and growth in some of those damaged areas, it seems like growth regulators can actually help improve recovery from there on, because you can, cut down on mowing inputs, which is going to help with recovery, and then actually help lateral movement of that grass. From a seed head suppression standpoint, that's a tougher question, because there are some concerns. I believe the label for one of the seed head materials says it can weaken the turf root system of newly germinated or newly established turf grass. So you don't want to inhibit rooting, it's going to be a course-by-course decision based on how severe the injury is. When it comes to the specific types of growth regulators, they're not all created equal. Some are going to work on the gibberellic acid component. Others are a mitotic inhibitor. The mitotic inhibitors typically cause a little bit more severe regulation or more long-term regulation. So those are ones that I probably lean away from if you're still going to make that seed head application. But again, it's going to be a green by green decision based on how severe it is. If it's out of play, seed heads aren't really that much of an issue from a playability standpoint, but you do still want to suppress seed heads if possible, because that's going to help you conserve carbohydrates later in the season.
Okay, we're just about through. There's three of them that I want to tie up pretty quickly, and comments and a question. Bob Marshall just offers the observation. He says, we are 45 today and undercovers. Bob Marshall also said, just to comment, our best green is our only green with drainage. Jim Carr asked about using a specific product for plant recovery. Jim, I don't think the guys want to push any particular product on a webcast like this, but I know if you call them directly and you would like to visit with them about what they see working and not working, I'm sure they'd be happy to discuss that with you. But I'd rather not bring up specific product names right now on this type of a webcast, so I hope you understand that. One last or a question from Ryan, and then we will have one more after that. Are there studies showing increase in temperature of a grain surface when top dressed with black sand or dye or both? Are you guys aware of anything that would give somebody some quantifiable information as to the advantage of doing those practices? For sure, southern Jim. Grasses as far as painting and stuff, but I don't know about in y'all's part of the world.
Yeah, there have been some studies. I know there's been one out of Purdue University that looked at different sands just for green up in general, and then there was one from Ohio State and another one from Penn State a few years ago that also looked at these different sands for green up and recovery. They definitely have an impact. I recall the one from Purdue actually suggested that that tan sand was just as effective as black sand. You know, the other two from Ohio State and Penn State were pretty much the same thing. But, you know, what we're seeing still more so in the field is that black sand just being a little bit darker. It, you know, maybe it'll make a degree or two of difference over tan sand. But if you don't have that option of getting black sand, definitely going with your regular top dressing sand is worthwhile there.
All righty. Okay, last question, then we'll wrap this up, and I can answer this one. The question is, when will this webinar be available for replay? It will take us a little time to process it, which will be Monday or Tuesday. We'll have it up on the USGA's YouTube channel by Wednesday. As soon as the fellows from the Northeast submit their next regional update, if you go to usga.org and click on Course Care and then on Regional Updates, you know, you don't have to wait for the regional updates to come out in the Green Section Record. They're always posted on our site, and we will add the, as soon as the fellows submit their next one, we'll be sure to include that there. So the short answer is you should have access to it early next week if you go to the USGA's YouTube channel. And if you haven't done that before, it's just youtube.com, and then you type in USGA, and you'll see the USGA channel. Select that, and then you'll see just a little ways down the page, you'll see Course Care. And we're posting, we have quite a bit of information posted there, so you might grab a cup of coffee because it may take you a while to go through many of them. At that point, fellows, do you have any closing comments?
Not really, Jim. I think, you know, one of the underlying, you know, silver linings, if you will, is that although it's unfortunate how severe the winter was, I can assure you, your club is not alone in the damage. I had a presentation yesterday in London, Ontario, and there were probably 50-plus course representatives from different courses in that surrounding area that were all there to, you know, sort of join in and discuss winter damage, and that's a trend that we're seeing all over the region. So it's unfortunate, but you're not alone. It speaks to the severity of the winter that we had, and again, more ammunition to try to support growing better grasses, take trees out so you can get, you know, a healthier stand of bent grass, hopefully on your property over time, which is, you know, definitely going to help with preventing winter injury in the future.
Well, that's a perfect way to end it. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Dave.
All right. Jim, let me just add one more point. Some folks are undoubtedly going to look at this as a, you know, an anomaly, a very unusual occurrence, one every, you know, 20 or 30 years. The truth is 100-year storms can happen back to back and maybe even to back. So even if you haven't had winter injury in the past, I certainly would do whatever you can to set yourself up to weather it better, because it could happen again. It could happen again next year.
Well, that's a great way to end up, and I like Adam's comment about you're not alone. And, in fact, that's the title of Jim Skorulski's the Northeast Regional Update, which you will see in the record when it comes out today, is titled You're Not Alone. And as we read it here, I thought it was a great example of the type of update. I know many of the superintendents here today have blogs, which I think all of us would agree is a very good idea. This is the type of update from the Northeast fellows that you might want to consider running in your blog, which we encourage you to do. In fact, all of the Green Section materials are available to you to use in blogs. So, you know, be sure and take a look at that. It's a great way to communicate with your players and leadership and members of your club our course, what's going on out there from, you know, from the USGA. So with that, we'd like to thank everybody from, thank everybody for attending today. Fellas, you did a great job. I know the guys are wishing you all the best, and they're available to you at any time. Be sure and go to USGA.org and click on the, you know, about us. And we probably should have had the fellows' email addresses and phone numbers, but it will be in their regional update as well. And if you're not, you know, you've heard us refer quite often to the Green Section Record. If you're not subscribing, I can't imagine why. You know, it's free. It's full of great information. There's no advertisement. We encourage you to forward it on to your players, certainly to your staff. We're making every effort we can to get you very timely and unbiased information out there, which is the, you know, that's the mantra of the Green Section. So, again, we thank you for attending today. Look for the link and also look for our next webcast.
This has been another installment in the USGA webcast series. For more information on golf course management, visit www.usga.org and click on the Course Care tab.